Welcome to the second of four core convocations that Concordia is hosting this year. Each convocation is connected to one of the enduring questions that make up our core curriculum and exploration courses. This year we are focusing on what is freedom, how shall I live, what is truth, and tonight, what are my vocations? These convocations are often opportunities for Concordia to hear prominent speakers from outside of our community with the goal of sparking conversation on these enduring questions. Tonight, we wanted to use this time to bring our community closer together by having our very own president engage in dialogue with you, the student body. Dr. Michael Thomas came to Concordia Irvine right before the pandemic hit, and like the licensed captain that he is, he guided our ship through that threatening storm. He is dedicated to the mission of our university and to providing the best experience possible for the students here. Please help me in welcoming our president, Dr. Michael Thomas.
Well, thank you and good evening. So thank you, Dr. Tom, for that amazing introduction. And for the invitation, seriously, to give this convocation address this evening. So if you've seen the advertisements, I titled this talk, Our Vocations, How Our Lord Normally Works in the World. And so I'm going to focus tonight on two real major themes, vocations, plural, and how the Lord normally works. We know he can work miraculously, but it's more important how he works normally in the world. So this is likely the most practical address that I could possibly give. Yet it'll be filled, of course, because I'm a historian, it'll be filled with historical and theological context. I hope that the faculty and staff who are in attendance will also get something out of this talk, but the focus is really on the students who are in attendance this evening. My challenge for you, the students this evening, is to think deeply about not only your time here on campus, but to conjure up your future. Think out 10, 20, and dare I even challenge you, 30 years. Yes, I know it's hard to imagine, but tempus fugit. Time flies, as they say. And thinking about your vocations properly and clearly will help you live a life that is rich, full, and most importantly, balanced. But we'll get back to that in a few minutes. A few housekeeping matters. As an academic, I am punctilious when it comes to proper attestation and citation. This evening, therefore, presents me with quite a challenge. Much of the following address actually comes from things I've written, or maybe more importantly, discussed with my colleagues at my former university. The word with is the one I want to stress for the next few minutes, with my former colleagues. You see, much of what I'm going to share tonight is a composite document. My colleagues and I were faced with this similar challenge 10 years ago. How could we explain in digestible form for faculty, staff, and students the basic principles of Lutheran theology and how these play themselves out in a university setting? I myself took an initial cut at defining what it meant to be a Lutheran liberal arts university with professional programs. That document then formed the nascent structure of what became many documents co-written and co-edited over the years. Where one person's thought began and another's ended is lost to the keystrokes long, long ago. And even more importantly, the ephemeral words that we shared over, frankly, too many pints are lost to the ether. While I cannot trace individual thoughts, let alone specific words, to specific colleagues, I want to acknowledge that merry band of individuals with whom I formed these ideas. Reverend Dr. Philip Brandt, Reverend Jim Presnell, Reverend Dr. Chad Lakeys, Reverend Dr. Scott Yakimow, and Reverend Ted Engelbrecht. And let me add, for the good of the order, et alter, and other people, because there were so many people who engaged us in these thoughts about vocations. The thoughts I share with you this evening are many of our collective thoughts, and it would not be good, right, or salutary to begin this address without acknowledging the fact that this is a collective process. But let me now pivot to Concordia University Irvine and this new merry band of faculty and staff who have dedicated their lives to forming the students in this room and beyond into wise, honorable, and cultivated citizens. Throughout this address, I will use the collective first-person plural pronoun we, despite the risk that the jokes may follow as president using the royal we, but nonetheless, I will risk it. And why will I risk it? Because while the pandemic has not necessarily provided us an opportunity to sit around to talk deeply about vocation with one another, I think if we had a blank piece of paper a few years ago and sat down, we'd come pretty darn close as a collective here of the faculty and staff to formulating similar thoughts of what I'm going to share tonight about vocation with all of you. So with that risk acknowledged, let's dive in. So students, we believe that right now God is calling you to be a student. As a student at Concordia University Irvine, you not only go to class, study, and earn grades, but you also explore how your academic studies intersect with your beliefs, your faith, your passion, and your values. At CUI, no one compels you to believe this way or another, nor does anyone tell you what to study or what career to pursue, but many people are and will continue to assist you in thinking deeply about this journey of faith and learning. The ultimate goal of a Lutheran university education is for you to discover this intersection between your beliefs, your passions, and your career options. As this dialogue between faith and reason, between faith and learning takes place, you are being challenged to develop a worldview and a lifestyle that includes thoughtful inquiry, service and care for the earth, and service and care for your neighbor. God has called each of you by name to be the best student you can possibly be, for by so doing, you honor and serve God. Let me pause there. By being a student, you honor and serve God. That's the heart of vocation, and we're going to talk more about that. As part of your vocation as a student, you will have opportunities to serve others. You already have had opportunities to serve others throughout this community. Perhaps through community service, religious activities, a leader in a club or organization, maybe a member of student government. But in fact, God may in fact call you to new areas of service that you can't even imagine at this point. That is part of the excitement of this part of your life's journey, this part of your journey with God called a university education. There is never a dull moment. That is not to say life as a student is not full of struggles. It certainly is. However, the journey is worth the struggle now and throughout your life. For the staff and faculty in attendance, you already know that we work at an exceptional place, an institution that intentionally views what we do as faculty and staff in a different light than much of the world around us. Some things are the same, of course. We have work to do. We get paid, we sometimes are weary, and sometimes we're elated by our careers. We do not mean that working at Concordia University is in every way different, nor is it perfect. What we do find different, however, is the set of lenses that we use to interpret how and what we do. Out of that different vision, we do what we do differently and for different reasons. It is our Lutheran identity and theology that gives unique definition to what that different vision means, how that different vision shapes the way we approach our work. This discussion of study and work needs to start in the right place, which is, God is so glad that each and every one of you is here. He delights in what all of you do, and through you, God does amazing things for the sake of the Concordia community and beyond. If we are to make sense, any sense of that statement, we need to dive a little deeper into that Lutheran tradition we call vocation. So first, we're going to start with some historical content. So Christians have always lived within tension between the kingdom and the rule of God over heaven and earth and the push and pull of the workaday world. Jesus himself called his first disciples away from their nets to follow him, and he made them teachers of men. Sorry, made them fishers of men. Matthew 4. On the other hand, Paul, a teacher and a missionary and a writer of many letters in the Bible, conducted most of his ministry as a small business owner, a small businessman, operating a tent-making enterprise. Acts 18, 1 Thessalonians 2. Jesus described his followers with this enigmatic phrase. They were to be in the world, but not of the world. Throughout history, the followers of Jesus have labored to keep these two things in a healthy balance. But it is not easy. Sometimes they have been too much of the world, and at other times, they have not been sufficiently in the world. The Lutheran movement, of which Concordia is a part, was born in just such a time. Late medieval society from 1300 to 1500 AD held that a monastic life, or being a priest, the full definition of not of the world, was a shorter but steeper ascent to heaven than the life which was lived out as a soldier, a laborer, a farmer, or a mother. Truly definitions of being in the world. One of the reasons the Lutheran Reformation succeeded in the 1500s was because Martin Luther, a former priest in the Roman Catholic Church, articulated the notion that all of life was sacred. The monk or the priest did not do anything more holy than the mother who cared for her children or the cobbler laboring over a pair of shoes. God's hand blessed all these things. Jesus' life, death, and resurrection gave meaning to each of these vocations. The priest served God as a priest, but the cobbler served God as a cobbler. And the same needs to be said of the mother caring for her children, the stable boy cleaning out a stall, and the king exercising justice and making laws. In effect, Luther ended up rendering the whole of human life sacred. Even something as mundane as going to sleep at night became a service rendered to God as we care for our body, which God has given to us to serve others. God did not care for and become more involved with the monks and nuns in the religious orders than he cared for and was involved with the people of every other walk of life. For people who had been told for generations that real Christians wore priestly stoles and monastic robes and prayed seven times a day in a monastery, for those people, this was liberating. It gave them the occasion to see their whole world differently as something which was holy and good. In fact, Luther went so far as to say that the clergy of his day denied themselves a calling because they were so intent on serving God that they had ceased to serve others, which is the main way we serve God. The problem was that in the church of his day, most people were doing so-called good works to earn salvation. These good works included such things as pilgrimages, the veneration of relics, meaning the worship or the veneration of the remains of dead saints, fasting, entering monasteries, and of course the purchase of indulgences to reduce time in purgatory. But Luther taught that God does not need our good works. Our neighbor does. Luther's main theological contribution was that he rediscovered this very ancient truth that was found in the scriptures. God separated works from salvation. We do not do good works in order to be saved, but because we are saved. Luther, therefore, uncoupled works from salvation and connected them instead to vocations. Works coupled to vocation. They are bound to our life in this world, where our neighbor needs our works here and now, not in the world beyond. In other words, Works are service. And another word for service, in fact, the Latin word, is ministry. So vocation for Luther becomes an expression of our faith and the living out of God's purpose in our daily life and work. So that's the historical context. Let's shift now to the contemporary context of our day. So today, of course, we live in a very different context than the 16th century citizen. In Luther's time, men and women were flocking to the religious orders, and it was a religiously charged atmosphere. We may still honor and respect those who pursue a religious vocation as a pastor, a monk, a priest, and we especially in this room, might even think of that life as very holy. But our culture at large is not terribly interested in such holiness. One's faith is a private matter. Our public life, especially as far as the state is concerned, is to be separated from our spiritual life. When it comes to understanding our employment, this perspective suggests that our work is simply a means to make money, which we need to survive, and nothing more. Spirituality is an activity for the weekend, if at all. Some participate in religious worship services. Others define spirituality in an experience in nature or some other act of service, but it is safely isolated from the rest of the week. But there are some terribly good reasons behind this development. Horrible, terrible wars tore Europe apart in the 17th century. And the reason for that was an overly robust mingling of church and state led to these conflicts. Many people died and countless others suffered. The result was that many thinkers and leaders of that time then articulated a private role for religion in order to save religion itself from self-destruction. But one of the results of this thinking was that the everyday experience of people, of most people living today in the modern world, is stripped of any reference or relation to God outside of Sunday mornings. Religion was saved, but only for one day a week. Although addressing a different context and time, Luther's understanding of vocation also speaks to this generation. Rooted in the understanding that all we do is connected to God and what He wishes us to do, we speak of an exceptional and, frankly, an extraordinary study and work experience here at Concordia. God is not only interested in the hours spent in worship on Sunday morning, but His gracious, loving presence is extended to every moment of every day, including the working day, including the classroom. Our job is more than a job. It is worship, it is service, it is holy. So let's talk a little more about this theology, Luther's theology behind this notion of vocation for today. The idea that our work is somehow sacred connects it to God and His vision for creation and humanity's role in it. As Christians, we believe in the one to whom all creation belongs, including humans. The whole of creation belongs to God, Psalm 24, though in His love, He creates it for us and gives us joint management as stewards of it. Created in His image, He then who calls us would listen and respond to the ministry of taking care of the earth. That's Genesis 1 and 2. But we are also called to be a blessing of all peoples and nations who live on the earth. Genesis 12. The word vocation means calling. And for Christians, this implies being called by God in faith to love God and neighbor. As Lutherans, we chiefly show our love for God in worship and faith while we show our love to neighbor in service to him or her and the world. This calling involves both a privilege and a responsibility. But as Lutherans, we focus more on what God is doing through us rather than what we do on our own. The Lutheran idea of vocation is not so much a matter of law, what we are supposed to do, but rather it is a matter of the gospel, a manifestation of God's action what he has done and is doing in us. As Gene Veith pointed out in his book called God and Work, quote, "In this sense, vocation is not another burden placed upon us, something else to fail at, but a realm in which we can experience God's love and grace, both in the blessings we receive from others and in the way God is working through us despite our failures," close quote. This sense of vocation takes seriously the idea that God chooses to work through things and through people. In fact, this is nearly always how God works. And a line from my title, this is normally how he works. Indulge me for a moment as I unpack a little bit of Christian theology that undergirds this, the theology of incarnation. God taking on material flesh to carry out his divine will. God nearly always acts through his creation. Of course, this is most clearly seen and experienced in our Lord's willingness to take on human flesh to redeem and restore each of us wholly to a relationship with God. And as Lutherans, we know that God adopts us as sons and daughters through baptism. Ordinary water, which is infused with the Spirit of God, provides rebirth. We are fed at the Lord's table as ordinary bread and ordinary wine are likewise infused by the Word of God to be ingested by us to not only remind us of our Lord's sacrifice, quote, "Do this in remembrance of me," unquote, but so that he can feed us physically and spiritually so that we can carry out his will in this world. Yet this brings us to the other way that our Lord acts through ordinary creation, and one we often don't think about very often. Baptism, Eucharist, and ordinary creation of each of us. In each of us, as we serve our neighbors, infused by his Spirit, we become his fleshly ambassadors as we carry out our vocations. As Luther notes, God could have decided to populate the earth by creating each new person from the dust, as he did with Adam. But instead, he chose to create new life through the vocations of husbands and wives, through the vocations of fathers and mothers. Even when we pray in the Lord's Prayer for God to give us our daily bread, we know that he could, as on that hillside long ago, multiply bread and fishes, and feed us miraculously. But he doesn't normally do that. We much more often experience him providing our daily bread through the soil and the seed, through the farmer, the miller, the baker, and the shopkeeper. In other words, he gives us daily bread through the work of many people carrying out their particular vocations, beginning with the farmers and ending with the retailers. Luther calls these people the masks of God. Let that sink in. The masks of God. They're God's agents. But unbelievers see only the agents, only the masks, and not God. The giver of all, who conceals himself behind them and is seen only with the eyes of faith. Luther calls each of us in our various vocations the masks of God. Veith goes on to summarize this idea, quote, "That is, God hides himself in the workplace, in the family, the church, and even in secular society. To speak of God as being hidden is a way of describing his presence, even though he is not seen. To realize that the mundane activities that take up most of our lives," and listen carefully to this, "the mundane activities that take up our lives, going to work, attending class, taking the kids to soccer practice, picking up a few things at the store, going to church, are hiding places for God." This can be a revelation in itself, and for many of you in the room, it probably is tonight, thinking about those mundane ways that God interacts in our world. Most people see God in mystical experiences, in spectacular miracles, in the extraordinary acts that they themselves believe they have to do. To find him in vocation, however, literally brings God down to earth and makes us see how close he is to each of us and how he transfigures everyday life. This sense of vocation also takes seriously the idea that Christians are all called to be part of the priesthood of all believers. This does not mean that everyone is called to be a church worker, but rather that every kind of work has been turned into a sacred calling. It means that everyone is called to their various vocations to minister, to serve each other, and the world as they exercise their holy service to God and neighbor. Christians don't minister only to material needs, however, but also to spiritual ones. Nevertheless, as Lutherans, we understand that the Lord works in two kingdoms, the kingdom of the world and the kingdom of the church. And though he rules in both, each has its own prerogatives. And while the Christians are to be in the world but not of the world, we are called to live in tension with the fallen world. In other words, we are not allowed to eliminate the tension by either retreating from this world. Let me repeat that. We are not to retreat from this world, nor are we to uncritically embrace it. That's tension. We engage in the world by carrying out our vocations. And although there is not often a specific way of being a Christian carpenter, a Christian merchant, a Christian professor, rather, Christians are called to be salt and light to the world by living out our faith even as they live out their vocations. Being faithful at what we do in each of our vocation with God's help is often the catalyst for being asked to witness to the hope that is within us. 1 Peter 3. Christians, in carrying out their vocations, are different, and people notice this. So how do we navigate all these vocations in our lives? The reformers in the 16th and 17th centuries stressed that each of us have several callings, numerous callings, at the same time. We are called to our families, our schools, our work, our state, and sometimes even the world. The same person can be a daughter, a wife, a mother, an executive, while also serving on a school or community board, or also maybe engaging in a mission society. Each of these roles are important, and juggling the responsibilities of each can be a challenge. When Lutherans talk about the entirety of life being sacred, we also acknowledge several practical tensions and welcome them. We believe that our Concordia community is best served by people who are attending to their various vocations as students, as faculty members, as staff members, but also as spouses, parents, friends, children, neighbors, citizens, etc. For example, if you are neglecting your family for the sake of your job, that is a vocational problem. And ultimately, the university's community, its students, and its mission will suffer for that neglect. We are not suggesting that this is easy. And all of us have struggled on the score, but it is a struggle worth having. What then does vocation mean for each of us at Concordia, day in and day out, living through these activities? What does it mean to be Lutheran in the classroom or in the office cubicle or when interacting with staff, students, or faculty? So a few practical tips on how this might work. So let me start on a personal level. So on a personal level, I want to help you prioritize the many vocations by having you ask a single question. And to the students in the room, I want to reemphasize this question because this is the kind of question that if you keep this at the forefront of your minds, you will have that full balanced life I was talking about earlier. And here's the question. Who can do these things? Who can do these things? So I'll start by asking myself, who can do these things? So let me use myself as an example. Only I can be a husband to my wife. Only I can be a son to my parents. Only I can be a father to my children. No one else can fulfill these vocations. That means being a good spouse, parent, child must be, for me, a high priority. Many people can serve as the president of Concordia University Irvine. While I do not disparage my calling here, In fact, I consider it one of the clearest professional callings of my entire life. The task can be fulfilled by others, but at this moment in time, I am called by God to serve as the president in this vocational role. But who can do these things? This question helps us establish a hierarchy, an important hierarchy of vocation. So students, I urge you once again to take this counsel to heart, to ask the question, who can do these things? So let me give you, the students, a little more practical example for your lives today. As a student, your vocation currently is to excel in the classroom commensurate with your skills. While you likely have competing obligations, work, sports, maybe you're an RA, you're a club leader, you're an athlete, your primary vocation is as a student. You are called here to earn your diploma. Sometimes, however, you'll be called to serve first and foremost as a friend. There will likely be a night or two where you need to stay up to console a roommate. These hours might even cause you to miss class. That is a tension of your vocations, student and friend. However, if this happens night after night, then your vocational balance is thrown off. There are people at CUI whose vocation is to help students, and that is their calling. Allow them to fulfill their vocations, for example, as counselors, so that you can fulfill your primary vocation as student. And faculty and staff members in the room, remember that Concordia University embraces this theological perspective. We value your service, but never want anyone's service to happen in a way that makes fulfilling your other vocational responsibilities impossible. Everyone struggles to balance work, family, and community. So this convocational talk is entitled Our Vocations, How Our Lord Normally Works in the World. Hopefully this address has served as a catalyst for you to think differently about your vocations, whether you're a student, a staff member, a faculty member. At Concordia, vocations are so much more than careers. It is our vocations that the world meets our Lord, as we are the incarnational embodiments of his love to our world today. We are the masks of God. This is not a burden. It's an absolute joy. For Christ serves through each of us, using us as his instruments. And he is ultimately the reason why we serve. To God alone be the glory. Amen.
I would begin with a question, and it's a tricky one, probably for all of us. It's definitely a tricky question, though, for we of academic folks in a church-related college, and that is the doctrine of vocation is really great for those of us who have access to a liberal arts education like this. So we love to talk about these things. Yeah. To what extent would you say the church, and even to some extent the church-related schools, have an obligation or maybe an opportunity to think about ways in which perhaps women in, you know, kind of traditional church-related worlds and folks that perhaps are first generation or, you know, don't have the funds to go to a liberal arts college, what can we do to help people be able to fulfill what their callings are but they don't have the cash?
With all due respect, Professor Mallinson, I think you confused vocation with career. And so let me push on you a little bit there. Let me start with this, though. Let's start with some confession and absolution, right? So first of all, we've not done a good job, not at all. In fact, Lutheran theology has something to share to the world that is so needed in our day, right? This balance, this strange, bizarre way our society has privileged, you know, making money, putting job first, way over taking care of kids, other responsibilities, other callings in life. So we've not done a good job sharing the theology of vocation outward. But I think the point that Luther would, if I could put Luther's words towards your question, I think the very fact of the language that one carries out the will of God, not just as a priest acting as a priest, but as a mother raising her children, as a stable boy cleaning at the stalls, as a professor leading discussion, as a student going to class. So in that way, if we could maybe more fully promulgate this theology to the world, it would provide a very, very helpful balance to what your question was, and that is access. Because the one thing, you're right, there's all kinds of problems with students getting access because of lack of resources, lack of opportunities to come to a liberal arts college. But that's very different from vocation in the sense of God can use anyone in any space to love one's neighbor. So the important thing is that God could feed the world miraculously, but God doesn't feed the world that way. He feeds the world through uneducated farmers often. And so that's the point that I'm trying to emphasize with vocation. Of course, careers are also important. That's why I started with the purpose of our education here is to match your passions, your talents, your gifts with a career path. That is key to what we're doing here. But that, I think, is ancillary to Luther's understanding of vocation as making every aspect of life sacred. But now I'm ready for your pushback.
Only one, because the point's absolutely well taken, and you got me.
That's the goal, to get you. Yeah.
But the question behind it, I think, still stands, which is there are authorities that will deny that it is possible for certain people to have that vocation. I think this came up to us because we took a group of students, Concordia students, to another country that had a different education system, and we were asking them these questions like, what's your name, what's your hometown, who do you want to become? And one young woman said, you know, it's an interesting and poignant question you ask because there is what I feel called to do, and she was a Christian in a country that didn't have a lot of Christians. I have a calling. Mm. I think, this is an interesting and poignant one, I would like to be a preacher, but I'm in a denomination that doesn't let me, and I would like to preach the gospel in a country where it would be illegal. So I think the question for me is more, to what extent can we just concede that whatever the lot we have is, kind of almost like in a Hindu caste system, well, this is my calling because I'm forced to be here. Mm-hmm. Are there ever occasions when we have a sense that we have a calling, but we've got to fight for it or fight for somebody else to have that calling? And not prejudicing with the specific issues that I mentioned.
I think that happens. Let's use the Bible, right? I think there's examples, hundreds of examples in the scriptures about people who either felt a calling, who didn't want the calling, Jeremiah, Jonah, others, right? But your point, right, is that sometimes secular or legal authority curtails what one can do. Clearly, in Luther's day, right, there were the very strict protocols on who could do which vocations, right? I think that's our challenge, right? So that our Lutheran theology, yes, we're also beholden to the state and a culture that we live in the 21st century in America, but this theology should challenge us to think way beyond career and maybe in times encourage people to break outside of those constraints. This theology is very liberating, but it's also can be very challenging, can be very threatening. Imagine this theology spreading in India, for example. You mentioned the caste system. This theology in India, that's why in Lutheran theology in India took off among the lowest classes of the caste system. And of course, Christian missionaries, were threatened because they were giving the lower castes hope. Hope that God could use them in different ways and maybe use them in ways that the state wouldn't allow. So I'm probably all over the map, but this theology is dangerous if applied properly. Yeah. Other questions? Oh, great, he has notes.
Bench. Thank you, President Thomas, especially for the Latin language call-outs. My first question is, you said Christians in carrying out their vocations are different.
Yes.
Really?
No, we're not, actually. Not in carrying, well, it depends. It depends. So what Dr. Armstrong is challenging me on is technically we carry out the same vocations. So a secular professor and a professor of faith will be doing the same career, the same vocation, the same job. But it's the understanding the individual has as a Christian that something different is happening in the interaction. That it's not just an interaction between me and, say, my student Sally, but it's actually, if I understand that I'm a mask of God, Sally, let's say Sally's not a believer, Sally may not see God in me, but my hope as a Christian professor would be to act in such a way vis-a-vis Sally that she would come to ask, why are you different, a little bit different in your attitude, not in the profession. In the profession, it should be the same, but it's the attitude. It's the way we approach a student. And this is also where this can be complicated at a Christian university. So let me go on a side tangent for a minute. When I taught theology and history at my former institution for 16 years, often students would come in, and this would often happen, very much often happen in the theology classes. A student would get a D on an exam, and they would come to office hours and say, "How can you judge me on faith matters? And aren't you supposed to be forgiving?" Right? But that's a misunderstanding, right? Because as my role, and this often happened, I'm not ordained, so I'm not a pastor, but I had colleagues. I mentioned one of my really dear colleagues, Reverend Dr. Phil Brandt, and he would often have this discussion with a student that while he was wearing a sport jacket, right, as a professor, wearing the garb as a professor, he had a different vocation than if he put his stole on. So a student could come to the same office and face the same individual, Phil, but Phil had different vocations. Vocation as professor, he is assigning a grade. Now that student may break down and explain that their mom's just been diagnosed with cancer, their best friend is contemplating suicide, all kinds of things may be unraveling in their lives. At that point, Phil would then put his stole on and then talk to her as a pastor. But that's different from changing the grade. So that, I think, is what you're getting at a little bit, maybe. We all have different vocations, and they play out in different ways. But I think it's really the difference between a Christian professor and a secular professor at a Christian university is the way we interact with students, not in the day-to-day teaching of the class, but in how we do it. So, but help me out here, CJ. So.
I try to, with every credit hour, with every hour, face-to-face student, and I'd love to live up to that ideal. I continue to try to strive to point to the Christ. My other question is not a follow-up. Thank you for playing with me on that one.
Of course.
But just as you push back with Dr. Mallinson in regard to vocation and career or vocation and job, I think that in our culture we tend to confuse those terms, job and vocation or career and vocation. And this is difficult to work out. And you teach ancient history, I teach ancient history. I've just spent the last 2 weeks dealing in my ancient history class with the institutional reality of slavery. We're talking about it from the social history, and then we're doing ancient Roman poetry, we're doing Plautus, Pseudolus, and talking about the slavery, the lighter side, the comedy of it, right? This is pretty dark.
That's very dark.
We spent...
owning other human beings.
We spent 45 minutes today on a question, trying to make ancient history relevant. How can a job enslave you? Mm. Now let's talk about slavery, job, vocation. You talked about the Lutheran movement.
Yeah.
Does job, slavery, Lutheran mission have any overlap in any of that?
I was trying to get to this issue at the end of my talk, the idea of balance. because absolutely a job can enslave someone, relationships can enslave, the love of money can enslave. We can talk about all kinds of sinful approaches in life that can enslave. But it's that balance. I think that's the key. And what I'm trying to emphasize tonight is to challenge the students in the room to think out, because it's so easy in our culture to think about getting the piece of paper, right? Getting the job, right? Then you buy a house, perhaps you get married, right? These things start to enslave you. They can. But it's so important to remember that balance, that it's in all your vocations that God is working out and caring for the world. God absolutely cares for the world through my vocation, through the vocations of the people in this room. But also, just as important as my vocation as dad, as husband, as friend, as volunteer. And so that I think, yes, of course, you can get enslaved to anything. But it's that balance. And that's what I'm trying to emphasize tonight. So.
Well, let's thank our president one last time. Thank you very much, Dr. Thomas.